And welcome back to Jeff Koenange live at the Intercontinental Hotel here with House Majority Leader, also happens to be the Member of Parliament for Mr. Town, Honorable Aidan Duale. He's a man under fire, man under siege. In fact, they're calling for his immediate arrest. And his colleagues are even calling him, quote, a terrorist. The man in the middle, the Grand Mullah himself. Senior counsel and also publisher of Nairobi Law Monthly. We're discussing state of security, the state of the nation. Garissa going down to the genesis. Gentlemen, before the break, I said I was going to talk about two topics real quick. One, troops in Somalia, Grand Mullah, should we withdraw?
No, I don't think we should withdraw. I mean, it's not in our national interest, but I think there's need to do an audit in terms of what was our objective when we said we want to go into Somalia. What have we failed to achieve? And who is responsible for that? Because there are many people in this country, you know, that nobody takes them to account. I mean, nobody says that they have failed. Because when we were going to Somalia, and this, you know, everybody knows, you know, the former defense minister, the former internal security, the current chief of staff, all those people rationalized our entry into Somalia, that it will provide a buffer zone so that Al-Shabaab will not cross. Now that Al-Shabaab is crossing that, because I think there's even no barrier. Mm-hmm. What is Karangi's role in that failure? Because he's the chief of staff who took his soldiers there. He's still the chief of staff. Why is nobody asking Karangi? Why did, you know, he's the chief Kenya, he's the chief military strategist. He's the one who laid the roadmap on the invasion of Somalia. He's the one who rationalized. Now that we have failed, why is he not being taken to account? One, everybody knows that I don't think it was our objective, you know, really to create a buffer zone, because Karangi and his boys were not concerned about looking at Al-Shabaab. Karangi and his boys were more concerned about becoming custom officers in Kismayo Airport, because that's the thing they have.
Yes, everything from charcoal to sugar.
Yes, and this is what I call, you know, systemic institutional failure. When our soldiers in Kismayo are preoccupied with the pot, you know, the charcoal, the sugar, in fact, I'm told there were two custom officers, KRA officers, that were killed in Garissa. I think they were investigating the sugar import. Two of them were killed. Three of the police officers who were investigating were also killed.
Yes.
Nobody talks about this.
Nobody.
Yes, which means, you know, the people who have hunted down those custom officers and the police must be people who cannot be touched.
Yeah, yeah.
So there is need to audit, you know, the performance of the Kenyan army. Mm. I mean, we were proud of them, you know, when it took them, I think, 6 months to go to Kismayo. But what have they achieved since then?
Since then. Yes. Mushmuya, your thoughts?
One, I am very consistent that KDF should not withdraw from Somalia. And the fundamental reason is it's not in the interest of our national security. But two, look at it. Look at it historically. We went to Somalia in 2011.
Yep.
Called Linda Inchi. Yes. Who was in power? Raila Odinga was in office. Kalonzo Musyoka was the vice president. Moses Wetangula was the minister of foreign affairs. He's the one who went to IGAD to sign the documents. Mwai Kibaki was the president. Uhuru Kenyatta by then was struggling with the ICC case. He was the minister for finance. William Ruto was very far from. I was with him. We were forming a small party called URP by then. Were in the streets, we were sacked 2011. So we went to Somalia. As I'm saying, the primary objective was to secure Kenya, create a buffer zone, destroy the Al-Shabaab infrastructure. From where I sit, the discussion now in our country is not they should withdraw. The discussion in our country is what is their performance rate. We are told they are in charge of Kismayo. 30 kilometers outside Kismayo, Al-Shabaab is in charge. So the discussion that Kenyans should have today, the discourse should be, how are they performing in that? Secondly, the most porous part of our border, where we are now getting a lot of threats from the Al-Shabaab, is the Mandera sector, which is under the Ethiopian command within the AMISOM. And we have told the president a number of times, we have told government, it's part of our recommendation, that from Kiunga in Lamu to BP1 in Mandera, that sector should be given to the Kenya Defense Forces.
Would that help?
But
that will help.
There is also another school of thought. You know, When this operation to invade Somalia was being rationalized, the head of Kenyan intelligence at that time, General Gishangi, recruited 2,000 Kenyan Somalis. He took them to Manyani to train them. And he said that this will be the guys who will be providing security to the Somali government. Up to now, nobody knows where those 2,000 are. There's one school of thought that says that actually some of the people who are coming back to Kenya to carry out these attacks are the 2,000 Gishangi trained in. So, you know, I mean, there's need to do a big audit on the role of, you know, Gishangi, on the role of Karangi, all these guys. Because there are many steps they have taken that was thought to be rational at that time that has now boomerang on this country. Where, when you train 2,000 soldiers and then you don't have an audit of where they are, I mean, you can't, I mean, you need to be court-martialed.
Yes, okay. No, I want to confirm. In all the hearings we are doing from Garissa, Wajir, Mandera, that was a common narrative. The communities are asking, the real leaders, where is the whereabouts of those 2,000? So are they in Somalia? Are they in Kenya? Are they with
Al-Shabaab? So they're coming back to bite us where it hurts?
The possibility is there.
There's no doubt. There's no doubt.
Okay, what about what the Grand Mullah alluded to? Kismayo Port is a KRA. It's
custom officer.
It's a custom officer port. We've heard about the sugar barons.
One, Kismayo is a busy port like Mogadishu, like Mombasa. And the sugar and all any other goods come. And that's why you find the other common narrative is that there's a lot of contraband goods that leave Somalia, either Mogadishu or Kismayo, that come through Somalia to Kenya, where maybe part of it can be the resources which are financing Al-Shabaab. Because they're passing through the areas. I'm sure they're taking some taxes.
Maybe some but people in Garissa are profiting from
this. No. And then that can be also the conduit of smuggling of arms.
Yeah.
These are to be verified.
But sugar is money.
These are to be verified.
Let me say one thing.
But before Ahmed says,
yes.
I think once we start the discussion is how is our performance of KDF under AMISOM in Somalia, then the next question will be, do we have some other business outside our mandate in what is going on in the port of Mombasa, I mean port of Kismayo?
Which we probably
do. You know, the dysfunctional nature of the government when I alluded to is shown this very clearly by, I mean, last week, you know, the government, you know, froze 80-something accounts.
Hawalas.
You know, closed down hawalas, saying that the aim is to staff, you know, Al-Shabaab out of its money. It's a good thing, you know, if you have thought out, which I'm sure they have not. But look at, you know, the other side. When the Kenyan army allows for Al-Shabaab to export charcoal every time, Al-Shabaab gets in return millions of dollars to finance the wars they are waging against Kenya. I mean, it shows how poorly rational this government is. That they can close, you know, shops in Kenya, but allow the Kenyan army to run the charcoal business, which is the main source of income for Al-Shabaab.
It doesn't add up.
Of course
okay.
It doesn't.
Your leader, Deputy President William Ruto, announced over the weekend that in 3 months' time, the world's largest refugee camp, Dadaab, 600,000 plus refugees, will be shut down in 3 months' time. A, does that make sense? B, when I add 3 months, Obama will be flying into town as 600,000 refugees are making their way across the border. Help me out, my brother.
So what if Obama is coming in July and refugees are crossing the border?
Does that make sense?
Number one, what the deputy president said is also a recommendation from the Northeastern leaders.
You want them out?
Yes.
You want them out?
We had them for 21 years, over 21 years.
And they are the source of your problems?
Allow me. I mean, I want to give you intelligence brief. You know, you are not privy. You're not in government. We have the pleasure of sitting in government. You know?
Go on.
But this is intelligence. The same intelligence that has misled Kenya.
Thank you. The same intelligence.
Listen, at least we have intelligence. You guys have no intelligence. Intelligence has confirmed that there are cells of Al-Shabaab within the country. And I come from that county. I mean, there's serious criminal activity going on. Even before Al-Shabaab came to board, banditry. And these have been, there are a number of killings even within the refugee camp. And we have reached a stage where if Al-Shabaab cells are coming from the refugee camp, about 70 and 80 kilometers to Garissa, and kill 147 innocent Kenyans,
But we just said it wasn't Al-Shabaab.
No.
We said it's homegrown.
No, it's Al-Shabaab. I mean, homegrown means they use the local people and train them and then come back to kill our people.
Mm-hmm.
So we fail as a country. And it's not the first country. Tanzania did that to Burundi refugees. Al-Bashir, when there was a lot of militants in the refugee camps in Darfur, he asked for international staff of the UNHCR to leave and put local staff. So what we are doing is, we have an obligation under the constitution to protect lives of Kenyans. If the intelligence community provide, both locally and internationally, that the refugee camps are safe haven of Al-Shabaab. And I told you earlier, this country is at where U.S. was at September 11th.
So you want to send 600,000 people
600,000
across the border?
Let me finish. These 600,000 are mainly from the southern part of Somalia, which is under the control of KDF and AMISOM, within the umbrella of AMISOM. We are taking them back to Somalia, across the border, 30 kilometers. But let me tell you, Somalia must stabilize. And if UNHCR builds the camps in Somalia, provide security, that is the beginning.
There are international obligations, Grand Mullah. There are international obligations.
But I disagree with him on the refugees issues. And this is what I call escapism. When Kenyans don't want to address the reality of the issues they face, you know, they go to those poor refugees because they are soft targeted. First, if there is intelligence that that Al-Shabaab says, why don't you act on those intelligence and you know, neutralize them? But secondly, as you rightly say, we have agreed among ourselves as Kenyans, especially from the north, that most of these boys that execute Al-Shabaab's program are homegrown. Yes, I mean, so far there is no so far I've not read the intelligence, but so far there is no intelligence to show really that it is the refugees that are carrying this attack.
Yeah.
But I think also because they are soft target, we always easy to, you know,
correct.
But I think the important thing is let's not lose sight of the fact that for us to address this thing robustly, we must hold the locals to account.
Locals, including you people,
you
leaders.
Let me finish. We have signed the Vienna Convention. We have signed a lot of international obligations. But a time will come when the safety of our citizens is paramount to our international obligations. And this I've said it on the floor of the House. We have lived with these refugees for 21 years. Some of them have got, their children were born there, schools are there. A time has come even for Somalia. We want, as a country, we want a more stable Somalia.
And I agree
with Abdi Ahmed. He might not be having the intelligence, but the leadership, before the government has a number of times wanted to scale down the number of refugee camps in northern Kenya. Far over 500,000, more than the population of Garissa County. There are more refugees than the entire Garissa County.
Yeah,
environment, let me finish. There's serious environmental degradation.
You didn't know this before?
Did you just wake up and realize this? Let me tell you. No, we realized when we confirmed through intelligence.
And the answer is sending them back across
the
border.
Let me finish. Refugees go back every day across the world. They cross from Turkey to Syria to Iraq, from Ukraine to different European countries.
So you're willing to send your cousins back. Let them go back.
Let me tell you, Jeff, it's not about sending people back. And we're not sending them to no man's land. The Dadaab refugee camp is barely about 60 kilometers from the border. We're telling UNHCR, and they can ask for extension about 1 year or 6 months.
But you're giving them an ultimatum.
But ultimate goal, if President Uhuru Kenyatta and the Jubilee administration wants to safeguard, he has sworn to protect the lives and the property of the people of Kenya. He must, if intelligence have confirmed that the refugee camp in the Dadaab are safe haven, then the life of every Kenyan must be protected and they must go across.
But let's be fair. I mean, if you look at the incidents in Mandera, the two passes incidents, the last one in Garissa, I mean, those that occurred in Bukittinggi, those, you know, grenades that have been thrown so many times in Islii and in Mombasa. I mean, there's no evidence, whether intelligence or otherwise, to show that some people have traveled from the refugee camps and carried those. What we have, you know, and this is common sense, is that these are things that are carried by the locals, whether it's in Bukittinggi, or in Mombasa or in Garissa. You know, there is no need of looking for a solution where there is no solution. I mean, the refugees may go back, but the attacks may continue the next day.
Yeah. Yes. Have you failed your people? People are asking, the leadership of Garissa, the leadership of the North, have you failed your people?
How? I told you, we are leaders of the North, just like the leaders of Gitonga, the leaders of Buere. This is a collective responsibility on the people of Kenya, across political divide, to make sure Kenya is safe and secure and work with government. That's number one. Number two, and I've said that and I'll repeat, we, the leadership of Northern Kenya, for the first time, we have realized there's a serious homegrown terror. Before, Al-Shabaab were coming in from across the border with external people, but now they are recruiting our own people. And as a community, we have decided to take the challenge, to take the responsibility, and make sure our community becomes the first and most important in the war against.
In every part of the world, someone in your position, Member of Parliament for Garissa Town, where the attack happened, House Majority Leader, resignation immediately. Resign, go home.
If I was the Minister for Interior, I would resign. If I was the Minister for Interior, yes.
You're the MP of Garissa Town.
If I was the IG, the MP of Garissa Town, under the Constitution, Article 95, has three mandates: oversight, legislation, representation.
And he can also resign.
On what grounds? Representation? I don't deal with security.
You misrepresented your people. You let your people down.
What do you mean? I'm supposed to represent my people in Parliament.
If you didn't make a maiden speech, you should resign. That's representation, you know.
but
I think one point which we need to emphasize is, I think this, and this is, you know, the issue of responsibility. I mean, I don't know about Garissa, but if you look at Mandera, there is always a nexus, you know, between attacks and certain political events that are happening in the counties. Mm. I mean, these attacks really don't occur in vacuum. There's always some tensions, you know, between some communities. Yeah. There's always some wars. I mean, like Mandera, I think the government has been pressurized so many times, you know, to allow the recruitment of about 1,000, what do they call this?
KPR home guards.
Yes, home guards. Mm. And I think the government has refused. And every time that issue comes up, there's an attack that occurs. I don't know Garissa, but there is always a nexus. You know, there's some political agitation.
Sure. Okay, I want to talk more about that after the break. In fact, I want to talk about the fact that this list, when it comes out, who's to say you are not scapegoating some sub-clans of your major clan?
Which list?
You have clans up north. Who's to say you're not going to point fingers at clan so-and-so, clan so-and-so?
Your political rivals, in other words.
Correct.
Yes.
Who's to say?
Listen.
Hold on. After the break. At HON, Aiden Dwale, at Ahmed Nasir Law, at Koinanga Jeff. The hashtag is JKL, and I promise when we come back, I will read some of your tweets, which are literally coming in thick and fast. Jeff Koinanga Live is having a very sober debate on the way forward and also the genesis of terrorism in this country. Make that homegrown terrorism. We'll take a break. Be back in a moment.